Hello, Cycle 4 Lifers. It has been a good while since I've seen you guys. I've got some footage I'm going to edit and some videos I'm going to put up of some road racing that we've been doing for the last year. And the tire business has just absolutely dominated my life again. I dove full-time back into that. Still doing some side work for the dealers as a contractor in the wintertime and in between races. But today's video is, well, how are we going to get this truck ready to camp out of? Okay, just to get through the last few races of the year with this truck pulling the race hauler, I put a cheap REI cot in here and kept some gear bags full of clothes off to the side. And I had a little light with a snap-on light with a snap-on battery pack in it for lighting. And that's how I got through, you know, the last few races of the year, just working out of the back of the truck. But going into the winter time, I'm going to be doing some traveling, not a lot, but a little bit, and some more dealer contract work where it's going to take more than one day for a job, and I'm going to be hanging out close to these dealers and not wanting to pay for hotels. Plus, I might do a little hunting and some motocrossing. So I'm going to go ahead and fix this truck up into a livable space to use for the winter. And then when the springtime comes, we'll just roll right into tire season. And I'll have my little house at the racetrack. So the first thing you want to do, guys, when you set up an area to stay in, you got to start with a good floor, guys. You know, I can put curtains over the windows. I can back paint them. I can use Reflectix. I put Reflectix on the van windows. I don't know if you can see that through the tent, but that really helps to keep the heat in the wintertime when you're heating that space with a buddy heater. But I think the curtains look nicer. I think they just look better. So we're going to probably go with some curtains in here. It's going to be complicated to do the back window and the triangles. You know, I might just paint the triangles and be done with it and then put a curtain over the door. I'm not sure what I'm going to do. But we're going to have a bed. It's just a touch over 6 feet long, and I'm just a touch under 6 feet tall. So on that REI cot, it comes to the last edge right there, and I can sleep in here. So I don't think I'm going to keep that cot in here long term. I think I'm going to build a bed. But whether I build a bed or just keep using the cot temporarily, either way, you need a floor, because these ridges are not good for sleeping on with cots and legs and equipment and everything. You want a nice flat wooden surface that you can then carpet and make it extremely comfortable. So I primered over some of the rust spots. I bondoed over some of the rust spots. I had an actual hole poke through there. So I'm going to do some fiberglass repair on that. And I'll use the rest of that kit to work on the road race bikes, because I've got some fiberglass repair to do on the road race bikes. But I'll take a little bit of this kit and cover that hole. And then once you have a nice rust-free level floor, then it doesn't matter what it looks like. It doesn't matter cosmetically that it's, you know, all rough looking and stuff. This is just rust protection. Once we put that wood on it and some carpet, it'll look beautiful. You'll see. You won't even know what's under the wood. But you gotta protect them from rust, guys. You don't want to use plastic lay-in bed liners. That was what was on this truck when I bought it used, and it just destroyed underneath of it. The bed liners are supposed to protect the bed, so use a spray-in liner to protect your bed. The plastic insert liners, all they do is trap water underneath. And you can see all the rust that it causes and damage that it causes. So this is a fairly nice looking truck I got for a fairly decent price. Put a decent cap used on the back. I like the man door on this cap, because if I want to keep everything warm and dry, I can just real quick get my body in and out the center door, the glass door. Or if I'm loading equipment, I can lift that thing up and load it. The other thing you'll see as this video progresses, I'm going to design this interior. And by interior, we're talking about, you know, 12 volt deep cycle batteries to run 12 volt televisions and laptops and 110 power converters off of for power tools. You'll see when I'm done setting this up, it'll be just like the van. It'll be a mobile workshop. I can run tools out of it. Hell, I can run refrigerators in it if I wanted to. I won't, but it'll have the power to do it. So the thing is, though, is sometimes you need to use your truck for hauling stuff. And sometimes you need to change the configurations and whatnot. So you'll see when I build this, I'm going to make it modular. I'm going to make everything removable. You know, I'll have a bed that comes out. I'll have a countertop that comes out. Underneath the countertop, I'll have deep cycle batteries, you know, that can come out. It would take an hour to do it and another hour and a half to put it back. But if you needed this workspace to do something, to make money with it, or to fulfill a need in life, you know, or if you sold the truck and the guy you sell it to doesn't want all that stuff, you can gut it back out real quick and easy. So I'm not welding anything to the truck. I'm going to try like heck to not even bolt anything to the truck. That might be impossible depending on the design. I might have to put a few bolts in. But generally speaking, I'm going to try to build everything on the floor out of wood and then come up from the floor with removable wood pieces. You know, whether we have a slide-out drawer under the bed or whether the bed tips up and you can get in underneath of it with a tip-up, you know, top base, whatever we decide to do, it will all be able to just slide back out of the bed. All right, guys, I'm going to shut up. I'm going to put this fiberglass on that hole that poked through. I'm going to prime back over it. I'm going to measure the distances and the sizes of this, and then I'm going to go get some plywood. And next time you see me, we'll be putting that plywood in and starting the floor. Okay, guys, so we got the back of the truck sealed off from the environment. There's two tiny little pinhole vent holes in those rubber seals on the floor and two more little pinholes in the ones above it. And of course, these caps never really seal. Air's going to be going all through this thing anyway. So it's not that incredibly important as far as sealing. But what you do want to do is make sure you just don't encourage rust. You see where I glassed over that hole? Because with Bondo, you can use Bondo like I did over there to cover rust up and keep it from rusting. Of course, if that was a finished surface, like when I sanded this, then you know you would sand that down and make it look smooth. But there, it's under the ridges and plywood's going on anyway, so who cares? I just use Bondo to seal the exterior. But this actually had a structural hole in it, so I use fiberglass. And the reason I use fiberglass is you can put weight on it and it'll take some weight. So, you know, they make boats out of the stuff. So it's below the line of the runners, you know, the ridges. So all I'm going to do is just paint it to give it a uniform little look there. Just give it a little spray paint, no big deal. And that'll keep any water and any rain from poking up through the bed of the truck. And then when we lay our plywood down, it'll be weatherproof. So let's go ahead and get that plywood in there. Nicest looking section of it is probably out on this side, so we'll put it in this way. Okay, now show you guys a neat little trick on how to transfer your cutouts. Okay, we obviously don't want to leave these corners uncovered and have an uneven floor. So how do you know where to cut them out? Well, the way you do that is you take a ruler and you decide that the distance between the board and the ruler is exactly 7 inches. So that is the distance that the wheel well is coming out. So I'm going to take and remember that 7 inches is the line that I need for my cutout, okay? And then watch how I handle this. Okay, so my cutout is going to resemble something like that. Is it perfect? No. Is it beautiful? No. Do I care? No. But that's how you rough out, you know, a transfer cut like that. We'll do it over here. Okay, so there's your cutout for that hump. I'm going to do the same with that one like I did on that side of the wheel well. And back here, it's real straightforward and easy. Back here, you just figure out. That mark right there. And it's a straight corner. So I'll make those cuts on this piece of plywood, and then I'll mirror image it over there. I already looked at the truck before I turned the camera on. It's an exact mirror image of both sides. It has the same hump shapes. You have to watch that, because some trucks are unique right to left. Toyota put a hump in for the gas fill on both sides, but a lot of trucks don't do that. So, all right, I'm gonna finish putting this fender well marking in, and then cut this baby out. That's the basics of it. Just cutting out a rough template. I didn't do so good on that. I'll smash that with a hammer or trim it with a knife before I put it in. And then, yeah, that's one side. And then I'll show you how I'm going to overlap. I'm going to show you why I'm leaving the long side on the right of the truck and the short side on the left. It has to do with running the seam under the bed. I don't want that seam. I mean, it really wouldn't matter. I'm going to carpet the whole thing anyway eventually, but just for now, if this is under the bed, it's more convenient than slipping on it with your feet. So as I put this in, lay this in the truck, it fits really good, guys. It fits really nice. But there was a little detail that I wasn't thinking about. I wasn't thinking about ending it centered on a runner. You know, wouldn't it be nice for your seam to split right on a runner? And it's not a big deal. There's enough of an edge there to catch that lip if I cut it tight and right. But for future reference, when you guys are doing this, you should probably take, I'm going to do it. I'm going to take another quarter inch off of everything on this side, all the way down, just to slide it over that extra quarter inch more and get it right on the middle of that runner. So I'll be back. Since the first cut fits so good, I'm going to line it up on the second piece. Now obviously those lines are slightly in from the edge, from the thickness of the marker, so when you cut, you're going to cut on the outside of it to take more material away, right? Carpentry 101, guys. I mean, no offense, but if that's a little too hard for you, then this ain't for you. Get your neighbor to help. But so there's the basic lines. And I'm going to cut inboard of it to remove the full black line because of the width of the pen. And then we should be able to mirror image that piece right into that side of the truck. And then the challenge is going to be lining up the seam, because the chances of it being perfectly square with everything being hand cut, and even the pieces were hand cut at the Home Depot when I bought the full length, as I said, cut it to 75 inches for the length of that truck bed, at 76 and I wanted to leave an inch on the end. You know, you want to leave a little metal sticking out of the end just to protect everything, and to get a good seal on your thing if shifts move around, things move. So the chances of that seam squaring up when we go to cut that are almost zero. We'll probably have to draw a long line and hope we get that close to right. All right, here we go. So here's the basics of this. We got this side that we mirror imaged off of that side, pushed all the way left. We got this one pushed all the way right. Here's our seam, okay? I'm simply gonna draw a line right down the seam. Now when I cut this, a lot of you guys are gonna say, oh, leave it loose so the floor can jiggle around and breathe and expand and contract with weather. Well, there's truth in that. And if you're professionally laying down a slat board wood floor or something in somebody's house, yeah, I get all that. But this is the back of a work truck with two pieces of cheap plywood and a carpet runner. I really don't care if it moves one way or the other. The only thing I want breathing in the back of this truck is me. So what I really like to have is a tight fit. If it warps up a slight little bit somewhere along the line because it's tight, okay. Well, what, you know, who's gonna come and take my inspection papers away? But what I don't want is I don't want it moving and jostling going down the road because I'm gonna have stuff bolted and screwed down to it, and I don't want to warp and tweak and weaken fasteners and screws. So I'm gonna go ahead and trace this seam, and when I cut it, I'm gonna cut it for a tight fit. Okay, I want it tight. If it flexes a little bit in a way that's disadvantaged to what I'm doing, I'll deal with that. Why did I take the time to trace all the way down that edge and cut all the way down that line instead of using a prefabbed edge? A lot of you professionals might say, well, why didn't you use the flat edge on that and then do your cut it? Well, here's why. There's a slight quarter inch taper along the edges of these walls of this thing. There's no such thing as truly square back here. It's all stamped metal. There's no such thing as a truly professionally squared edge. So what I had to do was cut it to what I actually needed it to be, not to, you know, your perfection on a piece of paper somewhere, you know? So that's why I truly just marked it that way. So we're a little bit firm in a couple spots. I'm gonna show you how to solve this problem. See that, guys? Knocked it down under those little recessions and it worked. Let's get down the other end. It came out better than I thought it would, to be honest with you. Let's see what kind of damage we can cause down here. There we go. So, see, those were kind of holding me up. So, look at that. Nice tight fit. I can't wiggle it. Oh, look at that. I'm trying to push this way, and I can't do it, boys and girls. Nice. It's a little unsquared up there where you'll never see it, and it's squared up back there on that edge where you will. Ask me how I knew that was going to happen. Okay. I might be off the tiniest little bit of squareness there, but who cares? It's a nice flat level surface to build, you know, beds and sink tops and whatnots on, so we're good to go. All right, guys. Why are these 2x3s on top of the plywood? Just wait. Just keep your job from moving around while you're cutting. I started the first part of the cut, and then when the wood started to droop, I slid this trash can out to support it. You want to try to have a nice level cut, and you also don't want to run the saw blade through your county supplied trash cans because, you know, some politician might want $100 for that. So, all right, here we go. Next piece of engineering marvel and brilliance that I needed to bestow upon you today is the floor is 75 inches. It's technically 76, but it's, you know, 75 on the wood, right? The sink top that I got, why do I use a sink top? I've done this before. You don't want to work off plywood. You don't want to cook off plywood. You don't want to eat off of it. You don't want to make your coffee. And hell, I don't even want to put a laptop on it and watch a movie on wood. I want a nice, you know, homey style kitchen countertop style thing. Now, yeah, we're doing this cheap because it's just a thing we're using to camp out of when we're at the racetrack running these things. So yeah, you don't want to put a lot of money out. But I got this for, I think it was $70, which, you know, some of you might not have $70. God bless you. I love you. That's fine. Use plywood. It's okay. But, you know, if you can go spend $70-$80 and get a 72-inch piece of sink top material, then that gives you a nice place to work off of while you're in your camper. So I'm going to cut this out here for a bar sink. And then have some, you know, water drainage little thing underneath so I can wash my hands. I can make coffee. I can, you know, eat some eggs and wipe my hands off when I'm done cooking or before I start cooking. So if the countertop is going to be 72 inches and the floor is 75, why did I do that? Well, you want to leave some space on the end for access and moving around. Look at the back of this. It's curved. It's curved, boys and girls. It's not straight. It's straight up to about this point, relatively speaking. But as soon as you get here, you lose angle. So if your countertop's going to be above that, right, if it is, then you got to watch, you know, you're going to need a few inches of space there. So I'm thinking about it ending something like this and going up on the backsplash. And the backsplash barely covering the back of the window. Why do I want my backsplash to barely but not all the way cover the back of my window? They're called curtains, boys and girls. When you're sleeping in this thing, you're going to want to put some curtains up and not have people gawking in on you. You know, not that anybody wants to look at me anyway, but you know, if you want to put some privacy up there. You know, maybe you're camping out on a long trip at a Walmart and you don't want Walmart security to know you're sleeping in there. You know, what do they call that? Stealth camping or whatever. If you're on a long trip and you're trying to stealth through and not nobody know you're there, then you want to put some drapes up. So if the sink splash is out to about here where these clamps are, you know, the other question is, do I want to drill holes in this and get rid of the clamps? And for this side, I don't so much care because I could just put the sink right on top of them. Just add an inch to my dimensions, put the splash there, and literally, I just would not care. You'd never even see them. But over here, where you're going to be sleeping, it might be nice to not have those clamps there. So that might be a nice little part of the project is to drill some holes in the bed and actually bolt them down. This thing is sealed tight. I did a great job of using the right kind of seal. See the little corner of it sticking out there? I used the right kind of sealing material and it's the perfect fit for the truck. And don't kid yourself and buy the wrong cap and try to make it work. It doesn't. Buy the right cap to fit your truck, boys and girls. It'll seal better, okay? So we're gonna have the sink legs come up here and then the splash guard has a rail that goes over top. And I'm going to angle it back about, you know, an eighth of an inch. Not a lot. Just enough that if you're on reasonably level ground and you put a pen down, it's not going to roll off on the floor. You know, if you want something to roll back, you want it to roll back to the splash. You don't want it rolling out on the floor. So the other thing that you guys are going to criticize once you see this in place is the depth of the sink that I chose to use. I got a deep one. Not so much deep as in how deep the sink is, but how deep the countertop goes, okay? It's going to come out like fairly far into the middle aisleway. And you guys are going to be like, oh, you don't have enough room for a big bed. Everybody wants big beds and small countertops. I sleep alone in this thing. And it's cheaper that way. I plan on sleeping alone in this thing for a long time to come. So if I have a buddy that wants to camp with me, I can put him on a cot in the trailer. Or if I had to and I planned for it, I could take the countertop out and make the whole thing a bed if I want. But generally speaking, it's just me. And I don't need more than about 24 to 30 inches of bed space, really, to be comfortable. So you know, I'm not living in the thing. I'm just camping at it on the weekends here and there. So if you have about, you know, 24 to 30 inch bed, that's going to come out and look something like that, right? Now let's see how deep the counter space is. Okay, you guys are going to be critical and say, oh, it's taking up too much space. Trust me, when you start cooking on it, when you start putting those camping stoves up there on it or whatever you're doing, that's a full 24 inches. So you say, wow, if you got a 24 inch countertop and a 24 inch bed, how wide's a truck? You ain't gonna have no room to get in out up and down the middle aisle. Well, good point. 24 inches is to right about there, and that would be right about there on that side. And you're right, that center aisle is small. A lot of you guys say, well, I'd like to have a center aisle that I can convert to a double bed. There's a lot of you guys I saw did videos like this that did that. Great. If you need a lift up plank to make more level space, you go for that. That's your needs. I want you to have what you want. But for me, the only thing that's going to be in that hallway is my feet. So I don't need more than that. Okay. So let's go ahead and start roughing out this countertop, how we're going to do that. We know it's already 72 inches wide, so we're going to have a little bit of a backspace. The framing is not going to come to the edge. It's going to come in about here or something like that. Okay. And then I guess we'll, how about we do this? How about we lay the countertop right on those clamps? Just lay them right on top. Use them as like a foundation for it. Now let's put a 2x3 along there. Let's run a 2x3 along that center section to support it. All right, I'm gonna figure out what I'm gonna do with these clamps. I think I'm gonna go ahead and drill holes and get rid of these clamps. They're in my way. Okay, so to get up over these clamps, if I lay a 2x3 there, the thickness of that is going to be over the clamp anyway. So let's cut some, what is this, 2x3 I bought? Yeah. Let's cut some 2x3, lay it down right there just to give it a place to rest weight, and see how much taller than the clamps it comes up. And we can always use spacers on the other side and just work over the clamps. I got a feeling I'm going to want a low enough bed that the clamps aren't going to be in the way over here. I got a feeling that my head's going to be forward of that one, and you're not going to care where your feet are down here. And I'm going to want to be below that. Why below that? Well, look at the short height of the cap. It's a nice cap, and it's slightly taller than the cap of the truck by a little bit. It's got some rise to it. But by the time I sit my fanny right about here, I'm going to be hitting my head on the roof. So I don't need a lot of leg space or leg comfort. What I need is to be able to sit up and get dressed and sit up and talk on the phone and sit up. So I can spread my legs out any which way, but I want to be able to sit up, which means my tail fanny's got to be low on this bed structure. So if I'm going to build the bed under the clamps there, I can build the sink above it over here, and that'll actually be convenient for helping to hold the drapes back behind it from under the window. I think we're on to a winner here. There's the back of the base. You know, we could get fancy and take the clamps out and do something like this with it and all, but quick and easy, right? Plus I want something closer to the window so I can get the drapes behind it. So if we go there and we put the splash right, or the countertop backing right on it, that splash is fairly tall. It's going to come up right to the window. Let's see how tall that is. That splash comes up right to the window. Could be be a little bit of a challenge. Yeah, that's a nice, good, tall one, which is good because you want your drapes behind it. You're talking 4.5, 5 inches. So do we have 5 inches of space straight up from that board? If we put it halfway on that for support, that would go right to the window, wouldn't it? That would go right to the damn glass or the net. There's no room there. So if we set it right on the deck, we got to move the clamps. No matter what we do, we're moving clamps, aren't we? All right, let's do this then, ladies and gentlemen. Let's build a frame that sits right there, just above the clamp, like that, but out here. Right there. Okay, why do we want to do that? Because then we got 5 inches straight up in the air, and we got room to get the drapes behind the windows, and we got room to work the windows and clean the windows and all the other stuff you're supposed to do. Hey guys, as you can see on my kitchen countertop here, I left some backspace to get around those clamps. You don't have to frame to the very edge. All the weight is going to be up in here that you're leaning on and doing stuff. And you're not going to have that much weight. A camping stove, you know, you're not putting motorcycles up on it yet. So I just have a runner as far forward as I can get one, and then one a few inches back in to clear the clamps. Now, why did I go all the way to the edge down there but not up here? That's for the rim inside the truck, the rim of the cap, okay? If you can't see it from the camera angle, but that carpeted cap ledge is closer to the camera than that metal down there. The 75 inches on the floor and the 72 inch length is measured from the bottom, but that's not really accurate because that top, you know, the camper top is closer to us. So I left a little recession there on that, on those 2x3s. Now I cut 6 21-inchers, 21 1/4 to be exact, because why? That just clears the clamp, okay? So if I have four corners and one in the middle, and oh yeah, look at that, my wheel well's in the way. So, oops. Well, I'll figure out how to shim it against this flooring in the you know, back here. Or I can just put one in the very center, whatever. Not a big deal. But these are going to be my legs. Okay, the framing will sit in front of that. And then we'll frame it on the floor too. We'll put a runner on the floor. Or maybe we won't. It's more convenient for foot space. Nah, we will. We'll put a runner on the floor, and I'll tell you why. Because we're going to use this area for storage. And if you don't have that runner along that floor, then all your crap will spill out into the aisleway. So we're going to put a long runner right along the floor and do it that way. Okay, guys? Let me get the thing hung up in there and get a leg propping it up under there, and you can at least see what it's going to look like. And then I won't bother filming all the construction and all that. One thing I will show you that I did do, you got to watch these countertops, laminates, I think they are. If you're not careful, you can make these crack and make them look really ugly. Yeah, I'm not going back and siliconing them and doing all kind of fancy stuff to make it match the marble. Again, it's not inside somebody's house. But I did at least want to countersink it enough and get the head of the screw down in there so we didn't fracture that laminate. So when you drill your pilot hole for your screw, and yes, you have to use pilot holes on these because if you don't, you'll crack everything all to pieces. When you drill your pilot hole, you know, countersink it with a larger bit. You don't need a professional countersinker. You can, you know, here's the size of my pilot bit. Get it up in the light. That's the pilot bit. And I just countersunk it with a bigger drill bit that was, you know, slightly larger than the head size of the screw. And then I ran the screws down in. That one sank down a little bit lower, but there is one in there. But, you know, make sure you take enough care I mean, I know it's a rough project and it's just a camper in the back of a truck, but take enough care that you don't split that laminate, because once you do that, it's just going to be in the way, and it's going to, you slide stuff across it, it's going to hook on it. It's going to be a mess while you're cooking. It's a place for mold to get into. You just want to avoid all that. So, all right, I'm going to get it set up in there. Guys, it's going to look something basically like this. I've got it all the way up and over that ledge in the back, up and over these bull heads. This is what one of the leg won't live there, but that's just one leg kind of propping it up. I've got my slight back roll for like pens and stuff, not rolling off the desk. Now, here's the problem, and I didn't foresee this because I wasn't careful enough. It measures out to the end, and it's going to clear the door shock, and it's inside. That's all well and good. The door frame for the man door on the cap hits right there. So it's just a little bit too long, you know? So I gotta cut this countertop. I gotta do it, guys. Now, the question is, do I want to cut it level all the way back and just move these mounting screws down a little bit and just lop this off right here straight across, which would probably look neater. But it's hard to get countertop straight, and man, it's hard to cut it without jacking up that surface, man. I guarantee you, if I try that, I'm gonna be peeling and cracking all the way around. I'm gonna be mad. The other way to do it is just notch out a recession for that frame, which isn't a horrible bad idea, because that way, if you forget and leave something up there and you're driving down the road, there's less opportunity for it to fall out and spill down. Shouldn't really be doing that. You should be packing stuff in bags and trays when you're camping like that, but you know how life is. So what do we want to do here, guys? I think I just want to notch it. Then again, a couple extra inches of space to get in and out of the man door probably wouldn't hurt either. If I just move that whole thing back. Yeah. Let's take it out and do the best we can to cut it without chipping up that laminate, and just move the whole thing back. I took the easy way out. I neither notched it out with careful precision, nor did I try to cut a long multi-leveled line without chipping the laminate. I knew better than that. I tried to make one straight cut at an angle from here back. I did pretty good with that laminate. I'm going to sand that top and glue it later when I have a minute. But I was doing real good cutting it, and then I got to the very end, and the blade, you see where the blade wasn't long enough to get to the bottom of that? That was flapping, and that chittered that up a little bit. So, oh well, nice effort from an amateur, but I'm gonna sand that down and glue it, keep it from coming apart. But yeah, this clears everything. This lets me shut the cap, and it makes room for the recession, and I can also work the lock with no trouble. Plus, too, getting out in and out of the man door, this is the real reason I went ahead and gave into this. Getting in and out of the man door, you're going to have that much more room to maneuver, because the bed's going to be here. So it's going to be a tight spot getting in and out. But when you're in there, it's going to be warm and dry and cozy. Guys, there's the legs. I got corner brackets on them. See that? Nothing fancy. I decided against the runners because it might be nice to stretch out and get your feet under there. And I'm going to use other kind of storage containers to keep stuff from spilling out. So we'll see. I mean, I can always put a cabinet face on it or a runner or whatever. One thing you got to do, though, these flimsy, junky wood projects you do like this, they flex like this. That's okay in a treehouse, but when you're going down the road, you can't have that. So I'm going to put a fastener of some kind on the front corner leg and this back leg and pull them up to these hooks, because I learned years ago with metal, wood, rubber, any dang thing, if you're going down a road for thousands and hundreds of thousands of miles like I do, I drive hundreds of thousands of miles with these trucks going all around the country. And what happens is, vibrating going down a road, that will shake itself apart if you don't attach it and put tension on it. So I got to find some kind of little D-rings or hooks or something. If I don't have nothing, I might have to run to the hardware store, but I got to get something to, you know, attach like right here and then pull some tension down to it. Okay, next step. Guys, I got some, had these in my big trailer that I got from Dunlop, and I didn't need them because I did a different configuration in there. So I took them out of the floor where I didn't want them. And I'm using them to tension this cabinet. I mean, you know, it's going to be a cabinet. Right now it's just a countertop. But a sink will go in here, you know, a top mount. I'll cut a hole out and push it from the top down. And I'll have, you know, a drainage set up there so I can, you know, it wouldn't be something you could live out of. It wouldn't be a full-time thing unless you wanted to unless you wanted to do a lot of work cleaning the water out all the time. But for me, living out of it 4 or 5 days at a time, you know, I'd have enough water to last a few days, wash my hands, wash my face, do some cooking, and then enough gray water catch, you know, in a bluey to, you know, not have to dump it on the ground or whatever out in a public place. If you needed to build a laboratory in something like this, I won't bother, because where I go, there's bathhouses and laboratories and showers and stuff at the racetrack. But if you needed that for the setup that you were doing, you could put a camping toilet under your bed or under there and hide it out of the way and have yourself a little camping toilet. I don't need to, because I'm going to the racetrack and they have all that there. So, all right, see how once I tension that back a little bit, you could see that slight little programmed rollback I put in there. Look against that front window, and you see it fade back a little bit. If you take a sharp turn with pens up there driving down the road, they're coming off. But if you're parked somewhere and you're sitting still working on a laptop and you set a pen down, it's not going to roll that way. It's going to roll that way, you know, as long as you're parked on reasonably level surface. So, all right, guys, next step would be to put a cabinet on this, if that's what you were going to do. Put an open door there, put a slot out drawer. You know, some of you guys that work out of the back of your truck like to put your tools in sliders. You could lift the thing up and then slide your tools out. But none of that's me. For me, this is all going to be just stationary, you know, sink, water, gray water catch, and a bunch of clothes and camping gear up in the front. And then a way to permanently affix a camping stove up here, you know, with some little set screws or something. Years ago, I forgot and left a camping stove set up on a counter that I built in the back of a C10 Chevy truck, just like this, way back before van life and truck living was popular on YouTube. I was doing it back in the 1990s, running around the country, go racing. But 30 years ago, I left a camping stove up on one of these and drove away, and it fell on the ground and it twisted to propane, and propane was leaking everywhere, and thank gosh it didn't light off, but it was a mess. So if you're going to put a camping stove like this up on your counter, you want to have a way to affix it, you know? You want to have a way to put set screws in there or something to keep it from moving around. Don't rely on just putting it on the floor when you're done with it and then lifting it up on the counter when you're going to use it, because a day will come when you forget and you'll drive away with it sitting up there like I did. Safety first, guys. You motorcycle guys that came to my channel because you know me from road racing and motocross and stuff, wear your helmets. Always wear your helmets. Even when you test drive your bike around the block, you know, you fiddle with your bike at home and you run it illegally down the street, don't tell the cops, you know, but put your helmets on, guys. Two of my very dear friends in the last 30 years have had very, very serious life-changing injuries. And all they were doing was moving their bike in the pits.
one of them to go load it up after the weekend was over, and another one to get their bike out and take it over to tech inspection. They weren't even on the track. They weren't even racing. They just fell over in the pits from a freak accident and hit their head hard enough to change their lives. Wear your helmets, guys. Okay? All right, I love you. We'll take the next step another day. I'm going to get something to eat.
Hello, Cycle 4 lifers. It's part two, or next edit, or whatever you want to call it, of building the camper and the truck. I got the countertop in on the last section. Now we're doing the bed. So I transferred what I did to make this easy. So I wanted to have that nice fresh cut that was done, you know, at the factory. That's a factory perfectly straight cut. I wanted that to be on the edge of the bed, you know. I didn't want to trim the edge of this plywood out into the corners and then have to cut the bed where it was going to go, because I'm smart enough to know I don't have the tools to get a nice straight long cut like that, you know, with a saw like that. So if you're doing this at home like I am, sorry about the light, if you're doing this at home like I am, what you probably want to do is the same thing I decided. Make the factory cut the edge of the bed, or the edge of whatever you're building, cabinets, whatever. And then the side that's going to face the back, you know, cut along that edge. Because if I mess that up, nobody's going to care. So, well, I'm not going to care anyway, to be honest with you. So in order to get this wood trimmed out on the corners, you know, to get the actual trace of a nice fit, I laid it up on these containers. Because if you lay it flat, you're not going to get the right trace, you know, because the wheel well. So to get it up over the wheel well, I just laid it on these, and I traced these corners out. Well, then I figured out, okay, well, now your bed's too wide. But I don't want to cut it there and have an uneven cut. So I transferred that up. I just measured, you know, did the math. I wanted a bed that was 24 inches wide from the wall to the edge. It's a little thin, but it's a small truck, so I got to deal with it. So I just calculated the distance from there to there, which happened to be 9 inches exactly to the 16th. So I just added 9 inches to everything on the transfer and drew a new line. So now I'm going to cut on this end, on this edge. And if that's a little wavy and a little imperfect, so what? So that's how you transfer out your wall on that. Alright, let's get it in there and get some legs under it. The other issue to consider with your bed is how tall do you want it to be? You know, when I was working out of vans and stuff, or that van there, I had all the height to stand up in it. You know, you bend your neck over a little bit, but you can stand up in that van. You're not standing up in here. So you want the roof high enough that you can sit up in the bed straight without kinking your neck when you're sitting on the bed, which means you got to get it low. Okay. What does that mean? That means you can't put your feet out comfortably in front of you like you're sitting in a regular chair. Your feet are always going to be Indian style catawampus in front of you. So that's the lesser of two evils. I'd rather have my legs out dangling than have my neck bending when I'm trying to sit up straight and do something on the computer or whatever. So I'm going to put this bed low, you know. I'm going to probably try to sneak it right under those hooks, like right where my hand's at, but right above that ridge in the back wall. And if I'm lucky and I do this right, that should give me barely just enough height to sit up on the thing. We'll see if it works out. I'm going to start cutting these off. You can't cut intricate reliefs with a saw like that, a circular saw. You can. You just got to go back with a file or a little screwdriver if you care enough, smooth it out, which I promise you I do not. But you just go in with the blade there, and then, you know, you kind of line your indicator up on the front of the tool on that line. See that angle? So I didn't cut this out. I cut a notch there, and then I cut from back here, lining the tool all the way up. And then I went back here and did this cut. Then I went down here and did this cut. So you can see I messed that one up a little bit. I might have to retrim that. But that's how you can get intricate reliefs done with a circular saw. You don't need a jigsaw. Now, if you're getting into fancy cabinet work and all, and you want to do a fantastic job, well, do your thing. But yeah, this long cut here took a while. You know, I had to be patient and smooth. But it's not perfectly straight. It's pretty good. I mean, it's good enough for me, but you can see if you look down at it, it's not perfect like this factory cut edge is. That was the whole reason of doing the work to transfer it over. Why is this saw here? Nothing but weight. It's just holding the wood down on the trash can so I can cut it. All right, let's get it up in there, see what it looks like. So the bed's going to go just under this hook. I measured the height, which in my case was 10 inches minus the winch of the plywood, width of the plywood. So we're talking 9 and just over 1/2 inches, right, in length. So when you set the legs up in here, the plywood's on top, it's just going to barely clear that hook. Why did I want to clear that hook? Well, could I take it out? It's just on screws. Yeah, I could. No big deal. But it's a convenient place to tie stuff down to. That front one might not be at the same height, so I might have to wind up pulling that one out anyway. Who knows? We'll see. But here's the bed. Here's the legs for the bed. You put them this way, right? And then we're going to have some cross runners this way. You want a cross runner on the end to kind of protect the wood. Okay, on both ends where it's rubbing up against a truck and, you know, you're kicking it with your knees and equipment, loading it and getting in and out. So we're going to have a cross runner here on the end. And now the question is, how many do you need along the way? Well, for a 250-pound man, 200-pound man, 170-pound man, whoever's sleeping on this thing, you figure most of the weight's in the hip and chest area. So if you had a runner here and another runner here, you'd probably be just fine. You could probably get away with one right in the middle and just let it sink in a little bit under the memory foam. Who cares? But I'll put two in it and one on each end. So we're going to cut a total of 4 pieces that are the length of this. Now, why didn't this runner's on the front is a nice edge all the way down, because that's what's going to face into the working space. This back runner is recessed. It's recessed because all the gobbledygook with the wheel wells and the whatnots. Okay, so we're going to have a leg here in the corner, another leg in the corner, and then here we're going to have a leg kind of in the middle, like up along that central runner. So not going to have an exact, you know, back runner like you do on the front. So I recessed it in enough to give me room to put legs behind it like this. Okay, so I got the two legs up there, the two legs in the middle, one of which will go here instead of there, and then I got these two legs for the back, and I got this two braces in the center. This one I ran out of wood, and I didn't want to waste another piece, so I just shimmed it. It's hidden out of view. Nobody's going to see it anyway. I just put a shim piece in there. A lot of guys will make a lid out of this. They'll make their bed to where they can open a lid up and get to storage underneath. And that makes sense. I mean, if you want to do that, it makes sense. So the reason I elected not to is I'm just going to leave it open and slide stuff under it. You know, like cooking stoves or whatever, I can just slide stuff under there. There's not going to be a lot of storage space there. I want the bed real low to the ground. And why do I want the bed real low? Again, so I can sit up straight with my head. That's important to me. I'm going to spend a lot of time on laptops, a lot of time doing QuickBooks and tire business stuff, and I need to sit on that bed and work on that counter for a long time. Sometimes, you know, 45 minutes to an hour straight from time to time. So I'm going to put the 12-volt system on the right side because myself and the two batteries for the 12 volt are the heaviest two things that ever sit in the truck. You know, this water, some clothes, a bed, sleeping bag, none of that stuff weighs anything. It's all lightweight. But the driver's always in the driver's seat. And I'm always sleeping on this side of the truck. So I'm pushing down on the left side of the truck constantly with the heaviest thing that's going to be in the truck, which is me. So I'm going to balance that out by putting my two 12-volt deep cycles on the right side. A lot of guys talk about off-gassing and, oh, don't have your deep cycle batteries in the same compartment you sleep in. Well, it's ventilated enough. I've been doing it for years, and I've never had a problem. If that bothers you, don't do it, you know? But it doesn't bother me. So, there you go, guys. That's what it's going to look like. Hey, guys, there it is. There's the bed all tucked up inside of the nooks and crannies of the trailer. I mean, of the camper. And I'm going to adjust that center leg. I just threw it up in there so I could lay down on it and test the weight. But after I move that center leg and screw that down, pretty much be done. If you wanted to build a hatch with a lid, it wouldn't be hard. You could frame this in, you know, a little better, a little stronger. I didn't frame it too strong, and I'll tell you why. That plywood is sitting right on this leg, okay? The length of that leg goes right to the plywood. If you were going to build a frame strong enough to where you could hinge this up, you wouldn't have that, okay? So you would have multiple screws and more hardware and all that stuff. But for my purposes, where I'm not going to hinge the top in, I'm just going to leave it flat. It's working great. It's working really, really well. So I'm super satisfied with it. I got enough width between the countertop and the bed that I can run that heater and the heat can go up. I don't want to run it under the countertop. There's not enough clearance. And I don't want to run it on top of the countertop because you see that imperfection in the carpet up there? That's what happened when I ran it on top of the countertop. It was too close to that carpet and started melting the carpet. So it needs a lot of air space straight above that grate, guys. So I've got everything spaced out in here to where I can just barely make that safely work. All right, next step is going to be laying out the 12-volt system, seeing where the house batteries go and all that stuff.